how committed are we to obeying God? Obviously, there's a lot preached about in regard to personal obedience. I mean, in all honesty, that's what the Word of God is about, isn't it? It's not just simply about trusting in Jesus and getting your fire insurance, right? That's not what the Bible is all about. Although certainly salvation is a product of what we find in this book, what is even more important than that is the fact that we have a God who is so good that He inserted Himself into our timeline. And now think about that, okay? Because God is timeless, right? He's eternal. He has no beginning, no ending. And yet God took Himself and just kind of inserted Himself into our time and our space, invaded our world through His Son, Jesus Christ, so that He could do nothing less than, you know, die on the cross for our sins and redeem the human race. Now that is a God who is worth obeying, don't you think? Most certainly, and that's what the Scriptures are all about. It's about how committed we are to obeying. But as important as it is for us to obey God in a personal sense, there's also a greater aspect. There's a greater sphere as far as obedience is concerned. And that comes in the way of a church. Because you see, we as individuals need to obey our God. But we also need to obey God as a church. What do I mean by that? I mean as the congregation of believers, the folks that we have here this morning. Okay, not just the leadership. We have leaders in the church who are here this morning. Not just the leaders of the church, but all of us together as a church, the people of God, coming together in force. We as a group have to honor our God through obedience. Can a church disobey God? The answer is absolutely. There are churches all over this nation that disobey God, unfortunately. There are. In this day and age, sometimes it's very difficult to find a church that still preaches the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can turn on the television and you can find churches where they maybe they'll read a scripture passage or one verse right at the beginning of the message, and then you don't hear the Word of God for the rest of the time. And it's true. I remember watching one gentleman on TV, and I had heard about him, but I had never listened to his preaching. And I listened to him for about 5 minutes and went, "This is not preaching, this is motivational speaking." I'm not saying motivational speaking is wrong, but it's not preaching. Because it's not backed by the greatest authority that we have in this world, and that's the Word of God. And the Word of God gives us instructions on how to obey God. That's why it's called the Word of God, right? Because it instructs us on how we can please Him. Now, just right off, just to begin, yes, salvation is by grace through faith. We know that, right? We know that we cannot purchase our salvation. We know that there is no purchase price in the world great enough to purchase our freedom from sin and death, except for one thing. And what is that? The blood of Jesus Christ, right? That was the payment. His life was the payment for our lives. He bought us out of sin, out of death. That was free to us. Obviously, it cost God everything, didn't it? It cost Him His Son, Jesus Christ. But for us, that is free. But it's interesting because we've gone over this before, right? For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Okay? That's true. Absolutely. But read the next verse. What does it say? For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for what? Good works. Okay, God doesn't redeem us out of sin so that we can go back to sinfulness, right? He redeems us from sin so that we can live to honor Him. God redeemed us for something much greater. And you know what it was? You know what it is? It's to obey Him. It's to do what He says. And a big aspect of that is the Great Commission. Maybe you've heard of it. Maybe you haven't. Let me define it for you. Just in case there's somebody here who has no clue. Sometimes we in the church use these terms and we just assume everybody knows what they mean. Okay? Pastors are really, really bad about that. Okay? So as I was preparing this message, I was thinking to myself, I wonder if everybody even knows what that means. The Great Commission is essentially the last words of Jesus Christ to His church. It was His last commission. And if you know anything about the last words of someone, they are very, very important. I don't know how many times I've seen these emails or maybe something on Facebook or something where it says, the last words that this person uttered before they died were. And then they give those words. And you have to wonder, why in the world would anybody put a focus on the last words that someone says? Because they know why? Because they know their time is near. Right? They know that this is the last thing that they can say to the world before they depart. For Jesus, that was not death, though. He had already conquered that, right? For Jesus, that was very simply before He was taken back up into heaven, before He was re-glorified, before He took His place there at the right hand of the throne of God once again, as He had at the beginning of the world. And so Jesus, the Son of God, God come in the flesh, gave to us the Great Commission, His last, I guess you could say, His last will and testament to us. Now, there is a question that arises. The Great Commission, is it for us today? Okay, I don't know if you've ever come across someone who has contended that the Great Commission is not for today. Actually, I met a pastor who told me, my church does not engage in the Great Commission, the last words of Jesus Christ. My church does not, okay, let me define it simply, evangelize. Do you know what that means? It means go out and win souls. Okay, pull people in by preaching the gospel. So the gospel goes out and people come in. He said, we don't believe in that. In this church, because we just don't have the evangelistic spirit. And so I said, well, how do you explain all of these passages? Matthew 28, which we'll look at in just a moment. Acts chapter 1, which we'll look at in just a moment. How do you explain these things? You know what he told me? Well, we just don't have the gift of evangelism here. And that was only given to the disciples. That wasn't given to the church. So the disciples were the ones that were supposed to engage in that and were supposed to take the gospel everywhere they could. But that's not for the church. Okay? I'll tell you what. I looked at that church, and you know what? That church was stagnating. I wonder why. Because they weren't reproducing themselves. That is what the Great Commission is all about. That's the reason why Jesus gave it to not just 11 men who had endured through so much to come to the point where Jesus could give them these words. It wasn't just about 11 men who were going to, in a short-sighted way, take the gospel to, well, as many people as they possibly could. The disciples certainly didn't think about the Great Commission as just for themselves. I'll tell you why. You look at Acts chapter 2, Acts chapters 1 and 2, and you see that Jesus gave the command, stay in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 1. Okay, don't depart from Jerusalem. I'm sending someone very special. We know him today as the Holy Spirit, right? I'm sending you the Holy Spirit, but you need to stay in Jerusalem so that you can receive the gift from him. And so when we come to the end of Acts chapter 1 and we look at Acts chapter 2, what do we see? 11 men standing around in Jerusalem waiting for the Holy Spirit to come? No. We find 120 plus people waiting there. including Mary. And now that's interesting, because obviously Mary and those 120 people must have misunderstood Jesus. Because the Great Commission wasn't for them, it was just for those 11 men, right? And yet, Jesus said in the Great Commission, I'm sending you power from on high through the Holy Spirit, wait in Jerusalem. And instead of 11 men waiting in Jerusalem, you had 120 plus people. Why? Because they all assumed the Great Commission was for them. And there are other proofs of that as well. If you want to dispose of the Great Commission, guess what? You have to dispose of baptism too. Because Jesus said, after you win disciples, you need to baptize them. In Scripture, that's the command, and we'll see that in just a moment. That's the command for us to baptize. And the funny thing was, this pastor was the pastor of a Baptist church. And so, essentially, the answer to him would be, okay, then why are you at a Baptist church? Why do you baptize at all? Because that's part of the Great Commission. If it was only for those 11 men, why do you think that you should baptize? You're not part of the apostles. Folks, let me put it this way, okay? The Great Commission is for us. We need to be going out and sharing the gospel. We need to be going out and sharing our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I mean, why wouldn't anybody want to do that? You know what is inside of you. You know what God has revealed to you. You know what salvation is if you've truly trusted in Jesus Christ. And the question is, anybody who has made that commitment, how could they not bubble forth with Jesus, right? It's true. How could they not want to engage others to explain who Jesus Christ is? That is what truly the Great Commission is. It's us taking what God has given to us, and instead of being spiritual misers and hiding away in our heart, taking it and just letting it spew forth to land on whoever is nearest to us. That's the Great Commission. So let's talk about the Great Commission very quickly here. How does it relate to us? How does it relate to us, not just as individuals? Obviously, we need to be sharing our faith. But how can we, as Grizzly Flats Community Church, as a church body, as a group of people who come together, how can we determine to engage in the Great Commission? Well, we need to know some aspects of the Great Commission before we can determine that. And so this morning, I'd like to look at three aspects of the Great Commission. We're going to look at its elements, its extent, and its energy. Okay? Those are the three aspects of the Great Commission. Its elements, its extent, and its energy. Its elements we see in Matthew 28, and right at the end of that passage of Scripture, Jesus says in verse 18, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Okay, so in other words, hey, pretty important person here, Jesus Christ. Verse 19, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. It begins with evangelism. It begins with actually taking the gospel to people who have not heard it. And the assumption here is that we'll do it. The word go in our Bibles, in our English Bibles, looks like a command, right? You have kids. You know the command go, don't you? All right? Go. And normally in our household, it's followed by now. Okay? Right? It's a command. But here in the text, it's actually not a command. It's a participle, which I'm sure blesses your socks off. So let me explain to you what that means. As you are going. In other words, in your normal course of life, as you are going about what you normally do, take Jesus with you. Take the gospel with you. When Christ said this, he assumed that all Christians would take the gospel wherever they went. And the church must fulfill this. We need to fulfill it as individuals, but folks, Grizzly Flats Community Church needs to be engaging in evangelism, engaging in teaching people outside of these walls what Jesus is all about. And the assumption is that some will believe. It would be very depressing if Jesus had given to the disciples here, all of them, not just the 11, but the others that were following him, simply a command where, well, just do the best you can and hope for the best. But that's not the Great Commission. There is no futility in the instructions Christ gives here. He is assuming, obviously, the Son of God does not have to assume because he knows everything, right? But he's assuming that these men, when they go forward, will make disciples. In other words, it will happen. If you go, when you go, you will preach the gospel and something amazing will happen. People will turn from their wickedness, from the disgusting scum of sin, to glory, to the glory of God. You see, the church has to step outside of itself to bring the gospel to those who are outside. And if we do that, God will honor that. He'll honor that work. Why? Because Jesus said this 2,000 years ago, and it is as valid today as it was then. And so we need to be doing that. But what does it mean to make disciples? Well, this is more than just evangelism. It continues with discipleship. Now, that's the whole idea of a disciple. A disciple is not a club member. Okay, if you're sitting here this morning and thinking that you have your membership card and you're just a club member of Grizzly Flats Community Church, wrong idea, okay? That's not what the church is all about. Some people look at the church that way, don't they? Some people look at the church as if it's just some organization that we join. Boy, it makes us all feel good, right? But that's not what the church is all about. The church is all about making disciples. That's more than just evangelizing people. That's more than just telling them about Christ, presenting them to them decision to make, having them make it, and then saying, okay, go ahead and go on your way. Have fun, enjoy. The church is all about making disciples, going well beyond salvation. The church isn't just simply a hospital for the spiritually inept. Oh no, God, please, no. What is the church? It's a place where we grow, right? It's a place where we go beyond, okay, we've been given the grace of God. We're living the grace of God, praise to Him. It's all about living the life the way that we should. That's what the phrase make disciples means. It means make followers. It means those who will follow close on the footsteps of Jesus Christ, never to leave Him. Judas was not a follower. You know why? Because he didn't continue to follow, right? If you look at Judas, as far as his life, what do we know about him? He stole from the money bag and he turned Jesus in, right? For money, by the way. What was Judas following? He was following money. That was his idol. He wasn't following Jesus Christ. To make disciples is to follow Jesus Christ and to teach others how to do that. Amen. The point is, if someone follows Christ, they must be like Christ. And if we want to reproduce ourselves, if we want to go out there outside of these walls and share the gospel with people so that they can see the point of what following Christ is all about, we better be following Christ ourselves, right? Amen. We better have our own house in order, personally and certainly in regard to the church. And you know, it grieves me When I hear out in the community, and I do hear this, people who say, oh, well, I don't attend church there because it's just filled with hypocrites. Okay, well, number one, yes, they're correct. Okay? Because not one of us lives the way that we should, right? But number two, it grieves me because there's a functional aspect to that statement. Are we living like hypocrites? Should we be living like hypocrites? Absolutely not. Because if we are following Jesus Christ, He's not going to lead us into hypocrisy, is He? He's going to lead us into holiness. He's going to lead us into the way that we should be walking, the way that we should be living. And then, of course, the end of all of this process is bringing people into the church in a permanent way, being a permanent body of believers. That the whole concept, if you read throughout, especially the book of Acts, you look at the word baptize. You know what that meant? That didn't mean seeing people saved, telling them what true salvation is, and then baptizing them and sending them on their way. When people were baptized, they were baptized into the church. The assumption was that they would attend church. And this is what church membership is all about. I'm not talking about church formal membership. I'm not saying taking membership classes or anything like that, although that could be one aspect of church membership. That's formal church membership. But church membership can be as simple as from Sunday to Sunday attending the same congregation, being a part of that. Now, let me ask you a question. I think probably most of you already know the answer to this. Why do we attend church? I mean, we can go to our computers and we can sit down and we can turn on the monitor and turn on the computer and we can watch some great messages, some great sermons. We can do all kinds of amazing things on there. Now they have virtual churches where you're a little avatar and your little avatar walks in and sits down in the virtual church, and somebody on the other end will actually have a microphone. That I've actually seen this. It's pretty interesting. And they'll speak into the microphone and their little avatar goes blah, 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 and people actually watch the pastor on screen. Now, is that church? Should we be attending that in place of this? What is the difference?
No communication.
Fellowship.
Fellowship,
right? Fellowship. Here's another word, accountability. That little avatar can't keep you accountable, right? Because he doesn't know what you're doing on the other end of your computer. He has no clue. But see, that's what's scary about church, isn't it? Because now suddenly we have to open ourselves up to other people. Now suddenly we open ourselves up to criticism that we didn't have before. But you know what? That's the beauty of the church. The beauty of the church is the fact that we, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, God the Father orchestrating this whole mess, if I can put it that way, takes a group of people that, hey, we are a mess as individuals. We just are, okay? But brings us all together, creates something beautiful, so beautiful that he calls us his bride, which I think is an amazing picture of what the church is, so that we can become holier and holier, so we can become more and more like our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, so we can follow him better and better. That's what the church is all about. And when Jesus said, you baptize them, he was saying, you are associating these people with the church. Why? Because if they go out on their own, they're going to get lost. They're going to go by the wayside. They're going to do their own thing, but the church keeps them accountable. That's what's so important about this morning, folks. And I know I've harped on this before, but it's true. We meet together on Sunday morning so that we can be the Christians we need to be, right?
Amen.
So we can follow Christ more closely. Number two, the extent of the Great Commission. We find that in Acts chapter 1. And let me just read that for you very quickly here, because we are running out of time very quickly. But Acts chapter 1, we'll start in verse 4. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which, he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And I love Jesus' answer. Verse 7, he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. What is the extent of the Great Commission? Well, first of all, it includes our local communities. Notice Jesus mentioned Jerusalem. Now, when he mentioned all of these, Jerusalem, all Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost part of the earth, or all the rest of the earth, when he mentioned those, he actually meant literally Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria. That's what he meant. But I find it interesting, this pattern that he gave to his disciples. Jerusalem, that's where they lived, right? That was their neighborhood, wasn't it? So Jesus was calling them to carry the gospel to those they knew. That's hard to do. Why? Because people who you know generally know you back, right? And it's frightening sometimes to share faith with people because they don't just know the good things about you. They know the bad stuff too, right? And that can be frightening sometimes for people. But Jesus didn't say, well, if it makes you feel comfortable, then go ahead and share the gospel. Peter, you're an outgoing guy, so I know you can share the gospel in Jerusalem. The rest of you, you have a pass. That's not what Jesus said. He said, all of you, go and share the gospel in your own backyard. Why? Because that's the greatest sphere of influence you have. God has given you your neighborhood, your community, as a gift. Not as something to just live in. That's the problem with people. People look at life and they think life is just something that just happens. It just happens to them. But Jesus here is not saying, let life happen. He's saying, take the gospel to the people the closest to you, the people in your life, to those in Jerusalem, in all Judea. Well, what does that mean? Judea is a reference to the greater sphere of influence. Because a lot of us, we have that greater sphere of influence. We have our neighbors and our friends. We have Jerusalem. But then outside of that, we may have jobs, or we may have other social interaction or something like that. That's our Judea, that greater influence. How are we taking the gospel to those in our greater influence? And this certainly applies directly to the church, because I've asked myself the question, how is Grizzly Flats Community Church moving outside of itself to the community? And then how is Grizzly Flats Community Church moving to that greater sphere of influence? Because folks, we don't just have Grizzly Flats that needs to be saved. People in Grizzly Flats aren't the only ones that need to accept Christ and follow Him. There are those outside of here that need that too. How are we influencing them as individuals and as a church? And then Samaria and the end of the earth, that includes everything else. That may be as simple. I know some people do this, as simple as just sending a little track in every card. I know some people actually write and use the mail still, okay, instead of email. But just sending a Bible track out every time you send something out in the mail. Just simply slipping to somebody, maybe at a restaurant. Here, I just wanted to give you the gospel. I wanted to share Jesus Christ with you. It could be even on a church-wide basis. It could be as simple as a missions fund. If those of you who receive the budget, if you notice, there is actually there's a line item there for missions. And in the past, people have asked, why would you do that if you are below budget? Why would you give outside of the church? And the answer very simply is because Christ called us to. Because that missions budget is part of us fulfilling the Great Commission for our church. The extent of the Great Commission means we attempt to evangelize as many as we possibly can reach. And then number three, the energy of the Great Commission. I think this one's probably pretty obvious. What is the energy of the Great Commission? The Holy Spirit of God, right? And we've run out of time, so I'll give you the summary here. The Holy Spirit of God working through our salvation. The Holy Spirit does sometimes work through the unsaved, but not to the benefit of the unsaved. The Holy Spirit works through believers, and when He does, not only are those to whom He works through them benefited by it, but we're benefited as well. We have power from on high. We have God's power dwelling inside of us in the person of the Holy Spirit. How awesome is that?
It's unbelievable.
And when we don't share Jesus Christ with others, we are wasting a large part of that power that God has given us. Because he didn't say here, I'm giving you the Holy Spirit of God because I want to prove your salvation. That's not what he said. He didn't say, I'm giving you the Holy Spirit of God because I want you to do all kinds of incredible signs. That's not what he said. He said, I'm giving you the Holy Spirit of God so you can take the gospel to whoever needs to hear it. There it is, right? There it is. And you know what? We are wasting the power of the Holy Spirit when we don't share the gospel. And folks, I have to say, it concerns me sometimes when I look at the... And this is on the leadership of the church, okay? When I look sometimes at what we do to fulfill this great commission, I ask myself, and I ask God, mostly, are we doing what we should be doing? Are we fulfilling what God has called us to do in Acts chapter 1 and Matthew chapter 28? Because if we don't occasionally ask ourselves that question, it won't happen. That's just the human condition. The human condition is fickle. It's to look at our lives and say, well, you know, as important as the Great Commission is, I have to admit television's more. No, that's not the way it is, right? But that's the way that we look at things. Folks, we need to be sharing Jesus Christ with others. Why? Because he's the most precious thing we have. He is who we are, right? Isn't that what Paul said? When Christ, who is your life, shall appear, then you shall appear with him in glory. Christ is your life. If you've accepted him, if you follow him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, he is your life. Share that life with others. And we need to share that as a church. And we are going to, this next year, we are going to focus on sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with as many people as we can to make those opportunities, to be able to influence those, not just here in the easy reach community, but beyond ourselves. Because it's all about sharing Jesus Christ. The hope of our world is Jesus Christ. And so let's bring them the Great Commission. Let's bring the gospel to them.